Welcome to your Facebook page, Ammon Bundy. America is listening.
Well, I guess I'm glad to be here.
Well, you have no choice to a certain extent.
Well, I certainly find it interesting, the life I live right now, but it is what it is.
That's true. All right, where would you like to begin? You've had a lot of time to study liberty and some of our founding documents, the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, and where we've departed from those originally great principles, and how we are controlled and played against each other in society. The society is in turmoil, and we're factions are everywhere. Contention is everywhere.
It is everywhere. You know, I didn't really have an agenda for you. You started off a pretty good point right there. I mean, it's very interesting how everything is so contentious. You know, why are we so divided? What has brought us to this point? And I'm sure there's lots of opinions, and mine's just one. But, you know, what are your thoughts, Jared? What are your...
Well, we've heard the phrase divide and conquer, and that is an extremely useful philosophy. There's a story in the Bible where the enemy of Israel started fighting amongst themselves, and they were real easy to conquer. Well, the enemies of America, they love to have us fight with each other. While we're fighting with our neighbor out in the street, and you see it all the time nowadays, we're going to have a protest and go out in the street and yell at each other. But the guys that actually run your life are behind you watching the show in the street. You're no threat to them. They're the puppet masters. They're pulling your strings, and you're yelling at your neighbor when you should be united, observing true principles, and then we could have nice things again.
Yeah, that reminds me actually of something that I'm seeing in the Discovery here. On this case, and just kind of lay a couple little things that actually where they use those tactics or try to use those tactics on the community and our family. And one was, you know, so just to kind of give you a little bit of background, or at least the listeners a little bit of background, that obviously, you know, we have a ranch, and my dad has been in opposition to the federal government in
from an inmate facility
who owns the grazing rights. My family was there, been there since 1877, 140 years, and we've been grazing cattle on it the entire time, and we have deeds with the state of Nevada. And so we clearly claim those grazing rights. Well, they went through a federal court and, of course, got their little court orders to remove our cattle. And then in 2014, they came in full force. But in order, you know, of course, the military side of the Bureau of Land Management does not have the skills or the know-how to gather the cattle. That was hired out to what we call contract cowboys. And they were paid $966,000. Almost $1 million to gather our cattle while the Bureau of Land Management and all of its force were locking down the land and protecting them in that effort to do that. Well, before they actually started gathering the cattle, they set up a compound about 5 miles away from the house, the ranch home, in a wash called what's called Tocloff Wash. And there was a reporter that asked my dad if he, or it was actually a woman, that asked if my dad would go up and do a interview in front of kind of where the compound is, just off of I-15. And he agreed, and so they went up there. And during the time that they were up there, the contract cowboys came in. This was the first time they come in. So this was on, I believe, the 28th of March. This is the first time they came in with all their equipment. And we thought it was so interesting how the very small window of my dad being up there at the, you know, the entrance, which is still about a mile away from the actual compound, my dad being up there doing a kind of an interview and a photo op type thing by at the request of this reporter from Las Vegas. I mean, he was only there for about 35 to 45 minutes. And that little short time period in which he was there, and my couple of my brothers were there and stuff, was the same time that the contract cowboys came in that same entrance. And we thought it was, you know, very interesting. We couldn't, and anyway, there ended up being where we filmed the contract cowboys with our, you know, phones. And I think a couple things were said, like, shame on you and that kind of stuff. But that was pretty much it. And they went through. And we didn't think much of it until I get to the end of the discovery. And found out that somehow the BLM, the Bureau of Land Management, was aware that my dad was coming, or at least that he was there. And they held the contractors off at a location a few miles away until my dad was there and my brothers got out of the vehicle. They had other trucks, and they also had some horses because they were doing, like I said, a photo op. And they intentionally brought those contractors in at the same time. While they were filming out in the desert, they had a man, the BLM had a man out in the desert filming. And I think about that, and the only conclusion that I can come in is they were hoping that there was a confrontation.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
They were going to film that confrontation, and then they were going to use it as justification against my father and my family.
Yep.
This is factual. We've been able to clearly identify this in the radio transactions, the radio traffic reports, and it's factual. I'm not speaking.
This call is from an inmate facility.
The facts are this: they knew my dad was at the gate. They called him the patriarch. They said it was Clive and Bundy. They clearly identified him. They knew he was doing a photo op. The contractors were staged, you know, off site. And they were brought in at the exact same time my dad was at the front gate. And they were off in the desert and had a man filming them. And that those are the facts.
One more tactic trying to provoke your family into violence.
Yeah, and the interesting thing is, of course, my dad did not act, or any of my brothers acted in violence, very inappropriate in any way. They took pictures and filmed them of all the equipment, and they took pictures of their license plates and actually pictures of them in their trucks. Because those contractors had been warned in official notices. That they would be legally held accountable for their actions. And so they did that, and that's it. There was no confrontation. There was nothing to report of. And interesting as well, kind of as a side note, Jared, that they clearly filmed the whole event, but yet that film is nowhere in the discovery. And it's their obligation through different laws to disclose that exculpatory evidence. And they've withheld that, and I believe they did it hoping that we would never come to the understanding that meeting between the contractors and my father was staged and set up.
No, they wouldn't want that to come in front of the jury.
Yeah, these are the type of things that we're seeing. We're seeing also that, you know, the the First Amendment areas, you know, that everybody was so upset about and that bothered people.
This hall is from an inmate facility.
Rightfully so. I mean, they were literally, as many people said, trampling, as the governor of Nevada said, Governor Sandoval said, that they were trampling upon the constitutional rights of Nevadans. And he's right. And many others said that, such as Eric Parker, who said that the whole reason he came was to protest outside of the First Amendment area.
Yep.
Just kind of give a little background. The BLM set up two First Amendment areas, they called them, and they were just like corrals that made out of orange construction mesh. And they said anybody that wants to protest our actions has to do it inside these First Amendment areas. And they had two of them, and they had rules. The rules were you could only use one at a time. You couldn't use both of them at a time. You can only have, I think it was like, there was a limit of people you could have in the protest areas. And you could, the signs, any signs that be left or so would be disposed of within like 24 hours. So you couldn't have signs longer than that. And that was their rules. And it offended people, you know. And the BLM kept saying, well, we're doing it so that, you know, people have a place to protest and so forth.
Safely. Safely. It's always about safety.
Yeah, safety. But the discovery shows something different, Jared. Completely different. And it's very interesting because they set up those First Amendment areas to collect intelligence.
Hmm.
And they openly admit it in their own plans that we have. They say it was to collect evidence. They actually created out of two different teams, out of, you know, special agents, they say, plain clothes special agents, so they would not be in uniform. They called them the First Amendment teams. And they were to go and to mingle with the protesters in the First Amendment areas and collect intelligence and information on the people.
Mm-hmm.
And they were working in the reports, it says, and, you know, I probably should read you the actual quotes, but they were working with and directing this intelligence to the FBI. And they were, anyway, that was the motive and the reason for the First Amendment areas. It had nothing to do with the people and their rights and them trying to give a false attempt of, you know, people and their constitutional rights. It was there for their purposes.
Yep.
And also, secondly, Those First Amendment areas were to be used as justification to ticket, harass, arrest anyone who would protest outside the zones.
They were setting people up.
Yeah, so they basically, if they had the zones, the First Amendment zones, then they could justify anybody who was protesting outside the zone, they could justify arresting them or giving them a ticket or whatever, detaining them or whatever.
Sure.
Because they could say, look, you're not in your First Amendment area, so therefore you're going to get a ticket.
Yeah, you'd be interfering with a federal officer in the execution of his duties.
This call is from an inmate facility.
And so, you know, did that happen? Well, yeah, it happened. That's what happened to Davey when they beat him down. He was standing on the side of I-70 filming him with his iPad. He was 200 yards away from him, so he wasn't impeding in any way. But they literally surrounded him with snipers on the hill and beat him to the ground and took him to, you know, and interrogated him for almost 24 hours. Then they did it to several other people. There was an old man in the discovery that they arrested. There was some kids up on the mesa later that they arrested, actually earlier that they arrested, or not arrested, but they detained and confiscated their guns. Several people, you know, down in Overton, they arrested a couple. They were harassing people, and they were using those First Amendment areas as justification, saying, you're not protesting lawfully because you're not in the First Amendment areas, or legally, I should say. And that was their excuse. So those First Amendment areas had nothing to do with them somehow granting us
no
our rights. It had nothing to do with it. It was to trample on them.
Anybody that thinks the federal government has your rights in mind hasn't been paying attention for most of their life.
This call is from an inmate facility.
No, they really haven't, and it's unfortunate because, you know, they want to call us anti-government. That's just not the fact. It's just not true.
No, you proper role. You want real government so we can have a good life. And
that's right. We want government to put the people first and not themselves. And I mean, limited government. We want government to follow the law. And the law is the Constitution. And
yes.
I mean, it's pretty ironic when we literally walk around with constitutions in our front pocket, teaching it every opportunity we have, and the rights to others around us. And that Constitution is what created and gives power to these courts, the federal courts, and gives power to the federal government. And yet they want to say that we're anti-government.
No, we want proper government so our rights will be protected and everybody can mind their own business and have a nice day. This leads me to another idea that somebody wrote in and wanted you to discuss. These conflicts that we see in society, a lot of them are, I'll say all of them, in like the First Amendment area, the government we're all slaves to the same system, but the government uses that system against us. We're going to talk welfare. Now, welfare does not come from government in a legitimate free society. Government's job is only to ensure justice so that there will be peace. Charity always comes from the individual or the church or nobody at all. You cannot give what is not yours to give away, and that leads to a lot of problems in our society.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's not charity if it was forced, you know.
No, it's theft.
Forced to be taken, if it was taken from you by force and then given to somebody else. That's not charity. I mean, charity is when a willing person, out of the goodness of his heart, because he desires to help his fellow man, gives his goods, the what he has earned through his labor, and gives that to another person. That's charity. This idea that, you know, the government forcing us to give up the fruits of our labors so that they can distribute it to the poor. The idea that that's charity is just absolutely not true.
No. It's legalized plunder, to quote Bastiat in the law. It's theft.
Absolutely.
And it ensures a certain unprincipled voting base for the politicians who will do that. Because if unprincipled people know that they can vote for a certain guy and that guy will use the law, the guns, to steal from their neighbor, and then they get a piece of that, well, they're okay, because in their mind that's different than robbing, even though it's not different at all.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned Frederick Bastiat.
You have 1 minute remaining.
In his essay called The Law, and that, I mean, that just really is probably one of the best outline of what the law is for, and what is rightfully, how to rightfully be used. And I'll have to call you back when we talk about it a little further if you'd like.
You bet. Absolutely. Everybody is waiting to hear more.
Give me a few minutes. I'll call you back.
Watch the slideshow, ladies and gentlemen. Post your comments down at the bottom, and Ammon Bundy will be calling right back. Hopefully. You never know, but we're grateful he is talking to us now.
Our message is one of freedom and choice. Their message is of coercion and force. With my brother Ryan and I arrested and others, the FBI went on a massive witch hunt, arresting people from all over the United States. Many had nothing to do with Oregon, but were in support in 2014. I suppose they thought this was their chance to completely destroy any
Ammon Bundy. All phone calls are subject to monitoring and recording. You have $29.33. Thank you for using Amtel. You there?
Yes, sir. Welcome back. Glad you're here.
Well, just if you want to, just pick up where we left off.
Yep.
We're just talking about the true purpose of the law, which as the law is force, that's all it is. It's the combined force of the people. And that's all it is. It is literally just the force of the people, the uniting of the people, the uniting of their resources in order to actually force others that have supposedly broke the law. And that's what it is. But so we have to define, okay, that force, what is that force rightfully used for, and what is it not rightfully used for? And one thing that is for sure, that it is not rightfully used when through the barrel of the gun, a person is forced to give up the fruits of his labor so that another individual or individuals can decide where to spend that money. And that is absolutely not the right way to use the law or the force, which of the people. And rightfully, that force can only be used in the defense of another person's right.
Yes. That's what I said before. Government's proper role is only to ensure justice. If justice is observed, there will be peace. Charity does not come from government. It physically cannot. Charity always comes
from the
individual.
The idea that you give $100, I mean, if you want to give $100 charity, you give it to your neighbor for charity, and he gets $100. And you both feel blessed because of it. But if you give $100 to the government, or they take it to the barrel of the gun, but they take it, then what they do is the bureaucrats waste about 75% of it, and that's it. That's if you're lucky. And then maybe your neighbor gets 25% of it. And then your neighbor has to fit a certain criteria in order to get it. And that criteria actually benefits those who are giving it, as you were talking about.
Yes.
And so, I mean, the idea that it's a better system for people to receive charity, if you will, through the government is it's fault in every way, because most of it's wasted. And and the premise of it is done by force. I mean, literally, if you decide not to pay it or pay your taxes, you will be met with force.
Yes. Yep. And welfare makes a slave of everybody. The person receiving it does not progress in this life because they don't feel that they can, or they're the fallen nature of man. They get used to the handouts and they don't want to progress. It makes a slave out of everybody, the guy receiving it and the guy that it is being stolen from.
Absolutely. It does. And it's the wrong purpose in which the law was established. The law is there to actually keep that from happening. And if you want to look at it, you know, what is the service that the government is supposed to be providing? And that is protection of our liberties, protection of our inalienable rights. And that's it. So in life, liberty and property. And so if the government is doing anything beyond that, then they have usurped their power and are not, and are wasting your resources in that effort. So, And I know it's said many, many, many times in many different ways, probably a lot more articulate than I can say it, but it's just the fact of the purpose of government.
It breeds dependency instead of independency, and it does create faction. How many people look at these Black Lives Matter protesters and they immediately don't like them because they know a good percentage of them are on welfare. They know they've been in the jails. They know they don't like them.
Well, I mean, there's groups, there's factions, absolutely. They all have their own motives, some good, some bad, some mixed. Some are based off of correct principles, some are not. But the fact is a lot of it, the reason why they're upset or the reason why they've created is because of this actual unity in us feeling that there's something wrong. So we have to look down and dig deep and peel away this onion to get to the core of what's going on, and where we're at and why we're so divided. And if we could do that, then maybe we can unite and not have so much trouble with each other. I have my beliefs and understandings of what those core problems are. I'm sure others would agree with me. But but when it comes to welfare and it comes to what welfare does for us, one is it literally is a reason why our families, one of the main reasons why our families are being destroyed in this country. And without the family, you will have no unity. Without the family, you will have no teachings to the next generation of what is right and what is wrong. And the family is a central unit in society. And if you break down the family, and you literally break down society, and it becomes divided in so many different ways because there is no understanding of principles. There's no understanding of God and His role in our lives. There's no understanding of the purpose of life. That's not being perpetuated from generation to generation.
Nope.
And so it will just completely create a division where the nations will completely destroy themselves.
Yes. As the freedom will be destroyed, everybody there will still be under control. But when the family is destroyed, the state becomes the universal parent. And we see that in our public school system. Kids are there all day, both parents working. Kids are fed by the state, educated by the state, taken care of after school by the state. And this is what government wants. They want dependency, not independency. Bad government, the guys that are running the show. Back to these Black Lives Matter people, I believe a lot of them are the key organizers of all these groups are funded by secret combinations in government. There's something called Hegelian dialectic where Hegel was a contemporary of Marx, and you can cause a problem, and then government can show up with a solution, and it's always a trap.
Yeah, that is a very old tactic that those in power have used over and over again, and it's the very premise of why welfare, what we just talked about, is so destructive, because that's what they're doing. They've created a situation where it's becoming more and more difficult, I'll say that, to make a living, to create, start a business, to provide. 20 years ago, I started my business in the fleet maintenance business and, left the ranch there. And people ask me, why did you get into, decent mechanics? And have to explain and, you know, and not be in so much in the ranching. And although I've always helped my dad and tried to do what I can there and my brothers that are working there, but the ranch just simply isn't big enough to provide for as many families as my dad has. I mean, you know, I'm one of several siblings and, you know, the ranch just wasn't big enough. So my dad told me at a, I remember I was about 15, 16 years old. He told me pretty straightforward in a loving way that, you know, that this ranch just wasn't going to be big enough to provide for everybody's family. So I was going to have to go off, you know, I'm the fourth down the line. I'm going to have to go off and find another living. So
yep.
I did that in repairing diesel and managing and maintaining commercial trucks. That's what I've done. And so, but in the 20 years, I've seen a huge difference. I mean, it is, if I was to try to start that business now, like I did 20 years ago, I don't know if I would have made it. It's
no.
more difficult because of the bureaucratic regulations, because what is required of you and all the taxes and the insurance and the reporting. I mean, you've got to have a full-time staff just to support the bureaucratic regulations, and my business is fairly unregulated.
Yeah, you need a full-time staff and a lawyer.
Yeah, and a lawyer, yeah. And then you're always threatened with in every different direction with your freedom. You know, if you don't do what the bureaucrats want you to do, next thing you know, they're prosecuting you. And it could be over something as stupid as using an extra gallon of paint when you painted a vehicle because it puts you over the limit.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's the type of stuff that we run into, and they'll actually prosecute you for, and all the people out there go, oh, how wonderful the, you know, air quality control department is, you know, and yet they're making it so that business owners are, or potential business owners are frightened to even get into business.
They physically, they can't. They just can't. Yeah. It's too intimidating and too hard.
You know, and so it takes a person who's willing to buck the system, literally, in or a tremendous amount of money, one of the two, to actually live the American dream. And, you know, where I was going with that is what it causes poverty. If you can't be an employee, you know, and I'm generally speaking, I'm not saying that the American dream is completely snuffed out. Don't get me wrong, because I do believe it's still there. I do, but you have to be committed and almost flat out stubborn in order to get your feet established long enough to make it in business because of the bureaucracies. And so in return, the employment is not there because the small businesses have always been the primary employer of this nation. And when the employment is not there, the jobs are not there. And so you've got everybody fighting over the jobs that are there.
Yep.
And unemployment rises, which causes poverty, which increases welfare. And welfare is based upon a system and rules that destroys the family. And so, and then you have crime and generations after generations that are not taught the principles that are needed to be happy. They're not taught the way to live happy, which is in a family, which is loving your neighbor, which is respecting each other, which is not stealing and not lying and not committing adultery, you know, having a wife with children and a man and a woman with children. And that is the way to live happy. And so you literally see it on the front end and you see it on the back end, where this destruction of the family, which ultimately destroys the society, is being torn down. And just give you, I mean, a literal example is a man and a woman can't get the same type of welfare that a woman could get alone when she's not married.
Nope.
And so you literally have it where if they're dependent on welfare and not going out and providing for themselves, which is hard to do because we talked about that, then they cannot be married and cannot be supposedly, united in marriage.
Yep.
And so what you have is you have a whole bunch of men creating what they call baby's mamas.
Literally, yep.
They're going yep. out and they have no relationship with these women. They're going out and they're getting them pregnant. And then the more babies that they have, the more income they can get from welfare. And there's never any connection. There's no fathers teaching their children. You know, and I'm generally speaking again because I don't want to stereotype, but I'm speaking the truth here. And guess what? These prisons are clear full of people who have lived that way at least one or two or maybe three generations.
Yes.
And are doing that back. They don't have relationships with, they're not married. They have many, many children. They call the women in their lives babies' mamas. And the women in their lives call the men in their lives baby daddies.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not so much a new or now this, while we're talking several generations, it's not so much their fault. Although I'm not wanting to, personal responsibility is important, but they haven't been taught any different.
No. No.
And why? Because who was their dad? Their dad was a baby's daddy. That's yep. all he was.
They don't know who their daddy is.
No. A lot of them don't. And so you don't have that family unit where a mother and a father are living together in sacred matrimony, where they're teaching their children correct principles. And teaching them the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the proven way to be happy, and the proven way to have happy society is to live the gospel of Jesus Christ, among other things. But they're not being taught that. What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? I mean, is it not to love God and to love your neighbor with all your heart, mind, and strength?
Yep, first and greatest commandment. And the second is like unto it.
The second is like unto it. And so that is not being done. And until we correct that cycle, we will not heal as a nation. We will not be united. We will continue to see division. And until we heal the family, we will not recover. We will not... correct. We will do nothing but continue down this slope of destruction.
Yep. I don't see how anybody could disagree with you there if they really thought about these things. Look at it. Everything we do is against the family these days, and most of the men just let it happen. And here we are. Here we are. Nothing. It just keeps getting worse and worse. And we yell at each other and we fight with each other. And we don't stop and think and ask ourselves, who is the real enemy here? And it's the real enemy is we haven't embraced true principles. So we are led down to self-destruction as a nation. You read the Communist Manifesto and you study communism from the 1840s on, all through the Civil War and 1940s, and today, you can't have strong religious families in a communist country. It won't work. The men won't put up with it.
No, I mean, yeah, you're right. If you want an eye opener, read the Communist Manifesto. Read something like The Naked.
You have 1 minute remaining.
From Cleon Skousen. I mean, and understand that exactly what's happened to our nation is exactly what was predicted would happen and exactly what the manifesto says the Communist Manifesto says should happen. And you begin to understand who has devise this plan and what is their end goal. And they've almost accomplished it.
Very close, my friend, very close. It's everywhere, well, and we vote for it too many times.
Yeah, I'll call you right back, and maybe we can talk a little bit more about that. And
okay.
Give her one more round.
Last round with Ammon Bundy, ladies and gentlemen.
Now let me go on.
Recording. You have $25.13. Thank you for using Amtel.
Are you there?
Yes, yes. And everybody listening, back with Ammon Bundy and talking about factions and puppet masters and true principles and a huge conspiracy which has been ruining our lives for well over 100 years. And we haven't woken up yet. We will never defeat an enemy we do not understand or recognize. You think that guy out in the street that doesn't like your president is your enemy. And no, nonsense. No, the puppet masters are telling us what to think in the media, stirring us up to contention, to contend one with another. And it works like a charm for them. I wish we could stop.
Yeah, I'll give you another example that we found in the discovery. And again, it kind of relates to the First Amendment areas, because this First Amendment team that they built to, you know, collect intelligence and to, you know, collect information on people and to basically monitor the people. Once no one used the First Amendment areas, they were so disgusted with it, they would go up and look at it, but they wouldn't use it. And they had people out in the hills with high-tech, long-range opticals. Every time someone went, they would run their license plate and get all their information to put them on what was called the BOLO list. And I can tell you later what BOLO means if you don't know.
But be on the lookout.
That's right, be on the lookout. And so what's interesting is once no one was going to these areas, then the leadership, you know, the Department of Interior, Bureau of Land Management, gave a mission to the First Amendment team. And that was called I should have the information in front of me, but it was basically I apologize. I can't remember the terminology they called
it. No problem. No problem. It'll come back to you.
It had three objectives. And one was to collect intelligence. Two was to create a misinformation campaign, to promote a misinformation campaign. So their job was to go and mingle among the protesters. Now this would be at where the flags were on the private property, that where we had, you know, our put to mingle among them and to misinform the people. And that's what it was. That was their mission. And third, it was to distract them away from the cattle gathering. Now, I don't know what the details of the misinformation campaign was about, but it actually says in the planning reports and the mission reports of that day on April 7th, that the First Amendment team's job was to go out and to participate in this misinformation campaign, to misinform the people.
Yep.
And so, I mean, it's typical tactics, right? And so we get talking about the manifesto, the Communist Manifesto, and what what it says. And we get comparing these actions to federal government and sometimes the state and local, although they're much more in control of the people and accountable to them. So, you know, we get looking at their actions and we see, such as these misinformation campaigns, we see that this is a communist tactic.
Absolutely. It happens at the local level just the same, sir. State government run by Republicans and Democrats is the same as the federal government run by Republicans and Democrats. They are one and the same.
I would love to say it's not, but, you know, the bureaucratic rule has
taken
over on every level.
You've been begging for sheriffs to do their jobs. Every sheriff in this country is a Republican or a Democrat, and they're totally owned. Totally owned.
They are, and, you know, we could go into that for hours about, you know, the sheriff
facility.
And it would be a beneficial conversation for all of us. But we have to understand that our government is not our friend right now, and they're not in it for the people. They literally are not. They have an agenda. That agenda appears to be, I don't know how it could be argued with, that it is a communist, socialist, communist agenda. And that this has been a plan put in place since probably at least the 50s, if not before. I mean, I know it was way before that, but I'm talking about, you know, we leave the World War II and they just changed their tactics. Rather than using force, they began to use covert, you know, manipulation and to do it that way.
Yes. Well, we like to say we're against communists because it keeps the people scared and it turns their eyes towards the government for help. But we fund communism, we protect communism, we aid and abet communism, and we've been doing it for a very long time. Unless people are willing to read real history and accept the facts, they're contributing to the problem.
Well, what is communism? What is it? It's where the force of the people is used to make everything common. Okay, so there is no private property,
nope.
And the force of the people, the law that we talked about, is used to ensure that everything is owned by the government. And they say it's the people's right,
mm-hmm.
but it's not. It's controlled by an oligarchy, which is a small group of people in power, and they control it. They benefit from it. They use it how they want to, and they say it's the people's. And that's basically communism. But communism and socialism is basically where everything, the resources, you know, the industry, even the labors of the people is owned by the government. That's what it is. I mean, even in very definition, that's what it is. So you can't dispute that. So then you say, okay, well, what about our country? Are we a communist country or are we a socialist country? Which is socialism just one step away from communism, and always socialism always leads to communism, always has. And communism and socialism have always failed. In every example in history, they have failed.
Once the churches in this country are completely gone, our training will be complete.
Well, look at, are we a socialist? Are we going down a socialist, you know, path, or are we a socialist or communist country? Well, let me ask you this. We've got how many people saying we love our public lands, you know, protect our public lands, keep our public lands public, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is a misinformation campaign that they fed to people, especially in the West, all over. And what is that? How could there be a better example of communism, of socialism, than public lands?
Yeah, it's right there in the manifesto. If people listening, if you've never read the Communist Manifesto, go read it. And Republicans and Democrats have given you every bit of it. Every bit of it. But, we're there.
But use your brain, too. I mean, look at it. You have, you know, all this mass amount, 89% of Nevada, 69, I think, of Utah, you know, 53 of Oregon, and 51 of Arizona, and over 50% of the land in the West is claimed by the federal government, owned, what they say is owned by them, by the government, and that no one else can have rights on it. It is exactly what communism is in every aspect, in every definition, and yet we accept it and love it.
Well, we're told to. The ignorant will they'll tell the ignorant that if we don't get rid of the Bundys, you won't be able to go out in the desert and ride your bicycle. And that gets them on the government side so they can strip you guys of your rights and your property, and then you go away. But like a lady pointed out in Mesquite, eventually they'll come for you too. Government will use you.
Yeah, you're right. They will. And look at what's happened. For years, the only place that you could freely run like your camp where you want to, and I say this in general, but ride your ATVs where you want to, go where you would like to, and not be harassed by federal quote law enforcement, for years was right there where my dad, were the ranches. And why? Because my dad kept him clear of that. My dad would never acknowledge that authority. And for people enjoyed that and have enjoyed that for many, many, you know, for several decades. And so then the government comes in and says, oh, look, you know, Clive and Bundy doesn't have any rights here. They run them off. And then what is exactly what they want to do and what they have done?
Close it down.
They close it down. And yet the people say, well, if Clive and Bundy's there, the land could be closed down. But it's just opposite. It's insanity. No. And what does my dad do? He maintains all those waters up there. He provides water all over that land. So there's great places to camp. There's great places to hunt. The wildlife is, you know, much more plentiful and in areas that it would otherwise wouldn't be.
Yep.
And, you know, all because my dad is using the land the way it's been used for the last 140 years. And yet somehow we have it in our mind that the federal government and the government needs control of it. And all they'll do is close it off, police it so it's not enjoyable, and destroy the water infrastructure, and basically make it so that it's not enjoyable or even available to be used.
Not even accessible. We'll all be living in the city, in apartment buildings, have no contact with nature or the frontier. No, we'll be in the city, like Europe. You can't just go camping in Europe. You can't do that. You can't go hunting like that everywhere.
And people need to understand that the West was developed, you know, like I said, 150 years and so on, through what's called a multiple use. And that's the way it needs to remain, where individuals own property rights to it. For example, my dad owns the grazing rights, so he owns the forage rights, and he owns the water rights, and they're deeded with the state of Nevada. But that doesn't mean he owns the right to keep everybody off that land, because an individual, the citizens of that county have established the right to camp and to hunt there and to hike and to ATV there. That's their right. There might be a miner who has a mining claim. He has the subsurface rights, and he has the right to mine. And there might be someone who has forest rights, where they have a right to harvest the forest, and so on and so forth. And they've been used together.
All is from an inmate facility.
Primarily harmoniously for over a century. And that's the freedom that we have on this land. And for example, my dad, he can't build a fence and keep people out. He doesn't have that right. Neither would he ever want to do that. and neither does the ATV rider have a right to shoot my dad's water tank.
Nope.
But but they can live side by side, enjoy each other side by side, enjoy each other's rights side by side, and actually benefit each other. I mean, I can't tell you how many people will go out and they might find a water trough that's empty or a cow that's hurt, and they'll come to the ranch. They've been on their ATV. They'll come to the ranch and tell my dad where they found this cow or what water. And my dad, I mean, appreciates that so much, because now he, you know, he can go out there and take care of the problem, save a life, and get the waters back in there. And meanwhile, he has water that he's distributing all over the area, where what provides great places for people to stop and get a drink and to camp and to enjoy, and it works beautifully. And to think that we're going to put the government, federal government, in the middle of that, and all of a sudden now we're going to have more rights and it's going to be more enjoyable, is just ludicrous.
Yep. People should know by now that the government is not your friend, as you well said. Foreign conflicts. Don't you think we have enough problems at home without getting into other people's business across the pond?
Absolutely. I think that, you know, foreign matters and the way we deal with our neighbors, our neighboring nations, is no different than the way we deal and should deal with our neighbors next door, the house next door.
Yep.
And we do not have a right to go into another nation and to force our will or our policy or our on another nation. We have a right to defend ourselves, just like we do against our neighbors if we have to in our neighborhoods. But we do not have a right to go busting down their door because of something they said or something that has no bearing upon our safety.
No.
And until we understand that, we will always be in a world conflict.
Well, and a world conflict is a great way to keep us distracted, like we said before. But here's what I don't understand. People that think our government is corrupt at home somehow believe what they're being told about foreign nations. Our government has zero credibility. Why would we believe anything they say? But we do. Well, too many do.
Especially halfway across the world. You know, I've said it many times, but the battle for freedom for us is right here on my homeland. It's not across the seas.
No.
For us to send men across there when our freedom's being destroyed here is dangerous for us, and it's absolutely a distraction. But, you know, these wars, you know, as far as I could see, for the most part, and again, I speak generally because there's a lot of conflicts going on, but they're over control of the land and the resources in that area. And, you know, whether it's oil or whether it's opium or whatever it is, you know, these areas are rich with natural resources. And
yes,
certain individuals have gained control of those natural resources through the force of the people. And they cannot or do not want to let it go and do not want to let it up. And so they actually will create wars, and they'll make up ideas such as terrorism. And, you know, although that is a reality, but don't get me wrong, but they'll make this up as to get the people to buy into it, so that they'll fund their wars in order to control the natural resources in that area. And so what does it mean to the local people? What it means is that you have a foreign nation invading their lands and taking and controlling their natural resources through the barrel of a gun. That's what it means.
Yep.
And they literally will go, you know, our soldiers, and I speak out of respect. I don't want to give the wrong impression, but our soldiers are told and are going into these villages with their equipment and their weapons and their armored vehicles and their helmets and their armored vests and their guns, and they're literally terrorizing these villages.
This call is from an inmate facility.
Because there may be some resistance there, in what? In resistance in letting us take their resources.
Yes, that is the cold, hard truth.
And then we call them terrorists when they fight back.
That's right. George Washington was a terrorist, too. Well, depends on who you ask.
Yeah, I mean, those people have a right. I don't care who you are or what you say or what your belief is. Those people have a right to defend themselves. And they have the right to self-preservation as well.
You have 1 minute remaining.
Just because we're so powerful that we can, you know, destroy them in that right doesn't make it right for us.
No. No, and people have to get over this idea, this jingoistic idea that we're always right. I mean, that's pride at the worst level. Right is right and wrong is wrong. And again, George Washington warned us about foreign entanglements as he was leaving office. We never listened to George. We never listened to George about foreign wars. We never listened to George about political parties. He was the only president we ever got right. Ever since then, we've been messing things up. Ammon, thank you for coming on your Facebook page today, sir. You're a great educator. You wake people up, which is why you're at where you're at, sir. Godspeed, God bless. If you guys would like to call CCA 75 or go out and camp at Camp Liberty, go out. Do something. 775-751-4500, press 0 or 4 or whatever extension you like. Join us back next time on the Ammon Bundy Facebook page. This is real news. The real news is the news you do not hear on the television or the radio because that is completely controlled. Don't drink the Kool-Aid. Don't fall for that. It doesn't work to our benefit. Thank you very much. See you next time.
There. And during the time that they were up there, the contract cowboys came in. This was the first time they come in. So this was on, I believe, the 28th of March. This is the first time they came in with all their equipment. And we thought it was so interesting how the very small window of my dad being up there at the, you know, the entrance, which is still about a mile away from the actual compound. My dad being up there doing a kind of an interview and a photo op type thing at the request of this reporter from Las Vegas. I mean, he was only there for about 35 to 45 minutes. And that little short time period in which he was there, and a couple of my brothers were there and stuff, was the same time that the contract cowboys came in that same entrance. And we thought it was, you know, very interesting. We couldn't, and anyway, there ended up being where we filmed the contract cowboys with our, you know, phones. And I think a couple things were said, like shame on you and that kind of stuff. But that was pretty much it. And they went through. And we didn't think much of it until I get to the end of the discovery. And found out that somehow the BLM, the Bureau of Land Management, was aware that my dad was coming, or at least that he was there years, and we've been grazing cattle on it the entire time, and we have deeds with the state of Nevada. And so we clearly claimed those grazing rights. Well, they went through a federal court and, of course, got their little court orders to remove our cattle, and then in 2014 they came in full force. But in order, you know, of course, the military side of the Bureau of Land Management does not have the skills or the know-how to gather the cattle. That was hired out to what we call contract cowboys. And they were paid $966,000, almost $1 million, to gather our cattle while the Bureau of Land Management and all of its force were locking down the land and protecting them in that effort to do that. Well, before they actually started gathering the cattle, they set up a compound about 5 miles away from the house, the ranch home, in a wash called, what's called Toe Cloth Wash. And there was a reporter that asked my dad if he, or it was actually a woman, that asked if my dad would go up and do a interview in front of kind of where the compound is, just off of I-15. And he agreed, and so they went up there.
Extremely useful philosophy. There's a story in the Bible where the enemy of Israel started fighting amongst themselves, and they were real easy to conquer. Well, the enemies of America, they love to have us fight with each other. While we're fighting with our neighbor out in the street, and you see it all the time nowadays, we're going to have a protest and go out in the street and yell at each other. But the guys that actually run your life are behind you watching the show in the street. You're no threat to them. They're the puppet masters. They're pulling your strings, and you're yelling at your neighbor when you should be united, observing true principles, and then we could have nice things again.
Yeah, that reminds me actually of something that I'm seeing in the discovery here on this case, and just kind of lay a couple little things that actually where they use those tactics or try to use those tactics on my on the community and our family. And one was just to kind of give you a little bit of background, or at least the listeners a little bit of background, that obviously, you know, we have a ranch, and my dad has been in opposition to the federal government in
Bethell, from an inmate facility,
who owns the grazing rights. My family was there, been there since 1877, 140.
Welcome to your Facebook page, Ammon Bundy. America is listening.
Well, I guess I'm glad to be here.
Well, you have no choice to a certain extent.
Well, I certainly find it interesting, the life I live right now. But it is what it is.
That's true. All right. Where would you like to begin? You've had a lot of time to study liberty and some of our founding documents, the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, and where we've departed from those originally great principles, and how we are controlled and played against each other in society. The society is in turmoil, and we're factions everywhere. Contention is everywhere.
It is everywhere, you know. I didn't really have an agenda for you. You started off a pretty good point right there. I mean, it's very interesting how everything is so contentious. You know, why are we so divided? What has brought us to this point? And I'm sure there's lots of opinions, and mine's just one. But, you know, what are your thoughts, Jared? What are your...
Well, we've heard the phrase divide and conquer, and that is an extreme.
And they held the contractors off at a location a few miles away until my dad was there, and my brothers got out of the vehicle. They had other trucks, and they also had some horses because they were doing, like I said, a photo op. And they intentionally brought those contractors in at the same time. While they were filming out in the desert, they had a man, the BLM had a man out in the desert filming. And I think about that, and the only conclusion that I can come in is they were hoping that there was a confrontation.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
They were going to film that confrontation. And then they were going to use it as justification against my father and my family.
Yep.
This is factual. We've been able to clearly identify this in the radio transactions, the radio traffic reports, and it's factual. I'm not speaking.
This call is from an inmate facility.
The facts are this: they knew my dad was at the. at the gate. They called him the patriarch. They said it was Clive and Bundy. They clearly identified him. They knew he was doing a photo op. The contractors were staged, you know, off-site, and they were brought in at the exact same time my dad, exact same,